the New Mexico Museum of Art. We're very happy to have you here this evening for tonight's musical performance and historic lecture, Sombras Del Pais, Shadows of the Country, presented by Nancy Cooper and Carlos Archuleta. On November 25th, 1917, the New Mexico Museum of Art opened its doors to the public to celebrate the opening of the state's first art museum. The Saint Francis Auditorium, which is where we are right now, was built as part of the museum in order to provide the community and visitors a place to enjoy music concerts, lectures, and theatrical performances. We were very pleased last fall when Nancy Cooper came to us to propose that we do this program, and she'll tell you all about what's happening this evening. But I will tell you that all of the music that was performed, that is being performed tonight, was performed in the auditorium in the 1930s, including 1932, 1935, 1938. And the duo, Felipe Delgado and Anna Maude Van Hoose, performed to lift the spirits of the people during the Great Depression. For nearly 100 years, the museum has hosted lectures, concerts, memorials on a regular basis. We invite you to come back on November 25th, 2017 to celebrate our 100th birthday. And look at, if you want to know more about our 100 year celebration, you can visit our website and go to 100years.nmartmuseum.org. We would like to thank the following people, our companies, for making tonight's program possible: the Charles Redd Center for Western Studies, the Inn of the Governors, the Museum of New Mexico Foundation, and KSFR, specifically Lynn Klein. Please join me in welcoming Nancy Cooper and Carlos Ocholeta. Please enjoy the program this evening. Thank you.
Bill Carpenter. This absolutely fabulous work is known to almost no one but a few musicologists today. But it was very popular in the 1920s. It was performed here on this stage in July 7th, and there it goes, 1930, by Anna Maude Van Hoose, a talented soloist and accompanist who toured the United States in the early 20th century, but has been entirely forgotten today. 4 years ago, I began researching the life of Anna Maude, my great aunt, who I had never known. It was a shock to me, a professional musician myself, to learn the scope of her career and her talent. At this point, all the relatives who would have known her were gone, and almost all her papers and music were also gone. I still began the process of research, recreating her life through the reading of many old newspapers. As her list of performances grew on my laptop, I saw a recurring name alongside hers, that of Felipe Delgado. I have in the last year focused on their musical collaboration, which extended from the mid-1920s until 1940. I have met with some of Felipe's relatives. I have amassed a stack of wonderful little-known repertoire, such as what you just heard, and I have gained a tremendous admiration for their obvious talent. Tonight, you will hear music that was performed by the duo in concerts they performed here in 1930, 1932, and 1938. But first, a little about them and what made their performances so interesting. In the early 1920s, Felipe Delgado and Anna Maude Van Hoose joined countless other talented musicians, dancers, and actors from across America who flocked to Hollywood in the hopes of becoming a part of the new motion picture industry. Felipe Delgado, a young baritone from tiny Las Vegas, New Mexico, had been singing since childhood. Called The Boy with the Wonderful Voice, in a 1914 Las Vegas Daily Optic newspaper article, Delgado outgrew his surroundings, staying in town long enough to finish high school and then move to Hollywood. After a few years of music lessons, of voice lessons, Delgado began a regular dance program, a regular radio program on Los Angeles station KFI. He also studied dance with Ted Shawn, one of the founders of the Dennis Shawn Dancers, and began performing in Hollywood movie theaters as part of the pre-film entertainment. In the early days of film, large theaters had orchestras and would present something that would look to us like vaudeville prior to the showing of the film, with singers and dancers and sets and staging all accompanied by the orchestra. And this is one kind of dancing that Felipe did in his career in Hollywood. He also danced at nightclubs with his partner, Yvonne. Delgado's radio program, Media Hora Espanola, eventually received a prime weekend evening spot. It ran every week, it was entirely in Spanish, and it could be heard throughout the United States. I have found it listed in newspapers as far east as Connecticut and as far north as Seattle. It appeared clear that Delgado was a talent on the rise. Anna Maude Van Hoose, older by 20 years, was a veteran of the road by the time she arrived in Los Angeles in 1922. Born in Louisiana, Van Hoose was a graduate of the Chicago Musical College. She had taught at two small colleges in Mississippi and Louisiana before she decided that being a touring performer was the life for her. She began her touring with a Circuit Chautauqua program, if any of you are familiar with that, and she toured the United States from the West Coast to the East Coast and back again. In early 1922, she ended up in California, having toured the West Coast for most of the preceding autumn, and soon decided she was there to stay. Ted Shawn and Ruth St. Denis, founders of the Dennis Shawn Dancers and the Dennis Shawn School, are considered the originators of modern dance in America. Martha Graham got her start in their school, so they were her teachers. Ruth St. Denis hired Van Hoose shortly after her arrival in California, and she began to work for Dennis Shawn and accompany individual members of the dancers in performances around Los Angeles. It was there that she met Felipe Delgado. Their earliest performance that I have located was part of a benefit for injured World War I veterans at a hospital in Los Angeles in 1924. The two continued to appear together on occasion, but Van Hoose's work was more exclusively with Dinichon. Best picture ever. While Delgado was building his reputation in more diverse areas, in radio, with a dancing partner, Yvonne, in pre-film shows, and in film work. For a time, it looked like Delgado's film career would take off. A mid-20s newspaper article reported that Delgado's handsome appearance in several silent films won him the nickname of Valentino's understudy, and that Rudolph Valentino himself had taken an interest in the young man and has assisted him in getting a start in his profession. The record of Delgado's work in films is almost entirely lost, as silent films have been lost over time, and the ones that have survived never had a complete cast list. His only documented performance in film was an uncredited cameo in Paul Whiteman's 1931 film, King of Jazz, from which this is a still that I lifted from YouTube, in which Delgado played guitar and sang a short Spanish song to orchestral accompaniment during a part of the film titled Around the World. Although his name was left out of all cast lists, I was able to corroborate his participation thanks to one newspaper review that referred to his presence in this Around the World section. King of Jazz was restored by a group working out of the Library of Congress and had its new premiere at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City in May 2016. The archivist who spearheaded the restoration, and this is not a picture from the restoration, his pictures are much clearer and his sound is much better on the new version. But the archivist who spearheaded the restoration was working on a book about the film in last May, and I was able to catch him in his last week of proofreading and get Felipe's name included in the cast list. In spite of there being no other records of his presence in films, it's likely that he had small roles in many others. Delgado's newspaper reviews and publicity articles repeatedly mention his work in films, which undoubtedly refers to more than one. However, as the decade progressed, Delgado increasingly became committed to a career as a musician, focusing on the performance of Spanish language music and began looking for opportunities to give recitals as a vocal soloist. Whatever help Valentino could have given him in his career was brought to a halt with Valentino's untimely death in 1926. The popularity of Media Hora Espanola most likely caused Delgado to explore the idea of taking the show on the road. Delgado had already been accompanying himself on the guitar and had used several piano accompanists for his radio program, but he was now in need of a professional pianist who would commit to the touring and be more of a partner in the planning and the performance of the music. Delgado had actually performed for the first time here in the Saint Francis Auditorium in 1928 with an accompanist named Mrs. Adamson. The Santa Fe New Mexican described her as charming and reported that her grace and poise were most pleasing, and noted that she wore an old Delgado comb and a beautifully embroidered Spanish shawl. However, not one word was spoken about her abilities as a pianist. So it's not surprising she did not last long. At this point, Delgado likely looked back on his experience with Dinichon and remembered his past work with Van Hoose. He would have known by the late 1920s that the Dinichon school was closing as Ted Sean and Ruth St. Denis's marriage was breaking up. So Van Hoose was looking for a job. He offered her the job he wanted. She said yes, and for the next 10 years, the duo regularly toured the Southwest, particularly in New Mexico, as well as performing frequently throughout Southern California. Felipe and Anna Maude created a performance format that was truly a musical collaboration. They shared in the arrangements of the music they performed. In addition, Van Hoose performed solo piano music written in a Spanish style or written by a Hispanic composer. And I would add that that John Alden Carpenter piece was played in the 1930 concert. You'd be hard-pressed to call that Spanish influence, but the title is Tango, and that's why she used it. But she started looking around the repertoire after that, and that piece never occurred on the program. They also wore costumes in addition to performing Spanish language music. Their first concert performances as a duo were in July of 1930. They performed here in Santa Fe, but the newspaper did not give them a review. They performed first in Delgado's hometown of Las Vegas at the Normal, the New Mexico Normal University, where the campus newspaper reported they scored a decided hit. The Las Vegas Daily Optic had publicized the concert for days in advance, hailing Delgado as a favorite with the Las Vegas people and a Las Vegas boy who has made good, enticing potential attendees to purchase tickets with a report that Delgado possesses a voice of singular sweetness, clarity, and stirring quality, a handsome figure, and an ingratiating man. Romantic Spain lives again when Delgado lifts up his luscious, liquid tones. The president of the Normal gave the introduction on the night of the concert, remarking that every new triumph of the young artist is watched with prideful eyes by citizens of Las Vegas, and all feel assured of the fame that will ultimately be his. The review praised the concert, his extraordinarily perfect diction, his very pleasant personality, and had a few words for Van Hoose, complimenting her excellent solo numbers and saying, arguably a bit dismissively, that she did her work well. It is likely that there was some lack of objectivity in the newsroom of the Las Vegas Daily Optic, but a week later, the two performed at Albuquerque High School Auditorium for the final concert in their first tour, and the reviews could not have been more glowing. The reviewer reported that she played with true excellence, selections that were in themselves a concert, and that the lilt and rhythm of her playing brought delighted applause. These first concerts in July of 1930 took place 8 short months after the stock market crash of October 1929. It's remarkable that Delgado and Van Hoose would begin a touring schedule even as the economy was collapsing, and yet they continued to tour throughout the 30s, seemingly without financial difficulties. Advertisements for Delgado and Van Hoose's concerts in the 30s typically show ticket costs of between 50 cents and a dollar. Certainly this wasn't going to put money in their pockets, much less pay their travel from Los Angeles, where they both lived. At some early point in their collaboration, they began to subsidize their tours with the help of a group of patronesses. Delgado and Van Hoose accumulated a prestigious group of patronesses, women only, from diverse walks of life, appealing to many different groups of potential audience members. The list of patronesses included a marquesa, a baroness, and a princess. There was a prominent Mexican composer, Maria Grever. You'll hear several of her pieces later tonight. 4 members of the First Families of California were included, self-proclaimed. There was a musicologist, Eleanor Haig, whose research had focused on the early music of the Southwest, Mexico, and Central America, and who later contributed to New Mexico musical scholarship through her transcription of recordings of New Mexican alabados in the 1940s. One of the pieces she found in Mexico will be heard tonight. Mary Austin, the renowned author of both fiction and nonfiction on Southwestern themes, was a patroness. She lived in Santa Fe in the very early 30s. There were activists from Los Angeles, including Christine Sterling, known as the mother of Olvera Street, who spearheaded efforts to restore the oldest area in Los Angeles, and Consuelo de Bonzo, the manager of La Golondrina, a restaurant in the Olvera Street neighborhood that served as the headquarters for many gatherings of Hispanic artists and musicians in the 1930s, and where Felipe and Anna Maude performed several times. Louise Ward Watkins, the first California woman to run for Senate, was on the list, U.S. Senate, and so was Mrs. Charles Cooper, mother of actor Gary Cooper, and no relation. There were family members, there were personal friends from California, there were former colleagues from the Dinichon Dancers, and there were old friends from Las Vegas. The list of patronesses took up an entire page in all of their programs. There is no denying the good publicity photos increased the potential audience interest, and the duo had the great benefit of knowing acclaimed Hollywood photographer Lansing Brown. Brown arguably photographed more screen stars than any other portrait artist in California. With clients including Mary Pickford, who Gloria Swanson, Douglas Fairbanks, Dolores Del Rio, and Anna Maude and Felipe. And he could even make everyone look like a star. If you wanted to look like Valentino, that's Valentino, you could look like Valentino. That's Felipe. Valentino, Felipe. Same hat, it looks like same coat. Most of Felipe and Anna Maude's photographs seen tonight were likely taken by Lansing Brown, and these two definitely were. In a few short years, the concerts of Delgado and Van Hoose had become traditions in the communities where they took place. The programs were titled Sombras Del Pais, Shadows of the Country, a more evocative title of the mood of the music than just recital or concert. The duo's performances retained that title until their last concerts given together that I found in 1939. To keep the audiences coming back year after year, different repertoire had to be included. Delgado took regular trips into Mexico searching out new music, and he and Van Hoose would create new arrangements of the songs. Their programs were divided into sections, highlighting the music of Mexico in one set, that of California in another, New Mexico in another, and Argentina in yet another. These sections would be bookended with solo piano works that were Hispanic in nature and or flavor. Van Hoose would show her early training at Chicago Musical College when she performed such music, at least some of which would conceivably have been unknown to audiences in the smaller towns that they toured. Their appreciation for her performances were clear from many rave reviews, such as this from the Santa Fe New Mexican after their performance in 1932. Delgado owes a large share of his success to his equally brilliant and gracious pianist, Anna Maude Van Hoose, whose accompanying perfectly complements his voice in its every slightest nuance. She is a marvelous pianist, and her numbers on the program were magnificent. This review, like many others, showed the collaborative nature of their performances and recognized the equal partnership between the two. The final ingredient in these successful performances was the use of props. Delgado's sense of theater led to some unusual props choices. One review points out, sometimes he accompanies himself on his guitar, sometimes he smokes a cigarette on the stage. That's not in the review. As he muses in song as an Argentine gaucho, sometimes he accentuates the rhythm with gaily berythmed chords. And another reviewer vouches for the success of his theatrical delivery. His songs were interpreted with a dramatic fervor in which the audience was able to grasp the meaning of the numbers despite any unfamiliarity with the Spanish tongue. Costume changes provided a lot of visual interest for the audiences. Delgado made it a point to change costume with each set, wearing articles of clothing that in some cases had been in his family for generations. In one concert, he might wear gleaming white for the Spanish numbers, a sequin embroidered bronze satin blouse and tightly laced trousers for the Mexican group, and brilliant scarlet and blue for the early California group. In another concert, there was the sombrero and serape of the elegant caballero, the South American gaucho with his broad-brimmed black hat, and silver-green satin blouse and colored serape. It was during costume changes that Anna Maude would play her solo piano repertoire, another way of keeping the audience engaged. It is likely that Delgado provided some of his historic clothing to Van Hoose as well, who was photographed in a black lace dress and mantilla, which was also mentioned on occasion by reviewers. From another review, a Spanish shawl flung carelessly over a screen, a hand-woven blanket or serape draped over a bench, and the stage setting suggested the correct background for each group, while Miss Van Hoose, in white satin and lace, her lace mantilla caught in a cluster of scarlet blossoms, served to emphasize the color and beauty of Señor Delgado's characteristic costumes. Finally, many concerts included props that would appeal to audience members of all ages, live animals. In several newspaper articles, reviewers reported that Delgado cooed to a live white pigeon. The 1935 Stanford University reviewer says, Don Felipe held a white dove close to his face singing cuckoo, cuckoo, until it was difficult to tell which was bird and which was man. In the 1932 Santa Fe concert, the reviewer commented on the difficulty of choosing a favorite song of the evening and what prop helped to tip the scale. It would be difficult to discriminate, possibly his El Gallo, in peon costume and carrying his little rooster, Pollito Muy Bonito, appealed most to the audience. Delgado took the props concept to its arguably highest point when he introduced his own little burro, Segundo, onto the stage. Named for its August 2nd birthday, Delgado acquired Segundo in Las Vegas in 1933 when the burro was 2 weeks old and used him in subsequent concerts. He appeared on stage for years, showing up in reviews, including a performance of the duo at the Teatro Anapo of the Native Market in Santa Fe in August and September of 1937. And I've just got to say, as a performing musician myself, I cannot imagine performing and relying on animals to behave on the stage. In the 1930s, as determined from newspapers of the time, Delgado and Van Hoose gave at least 50 performances in Southern California, New Mexico, and Texas. Based on information from publicity articles, it is likely that Delgado and Van Hoose performed elsewhere in New Mexico. It's also possible, given the newspaper article references, that they performed in Arizona and that Delgado performed in Michigan, New York, Ohio, and elsewhere in the Midwest, although none of these have been conclusively documented. The duo's success on the road makes it reasonable to assume that their collaboration would have continued were it not for Delgado's untimely death in May 1940. Their performances were growing ever stronger and more successful, as evidenced by one of the last reviews I found from the Santa Fe, New Mexico, December 20th, 1938. Last night, Felipe Delgado sang again for Santa Fe, appearing at the Saint Francis Auditorium under the auspices of the Catholic Daughters of America. He gave a program of Spanish songs representative of five countries of Spanish musical tradition, accompanied by Anna Maude Van Hoose, a most excellent pianist. Delgado was a new discovery to this critic, and he and Van Hoose gave the kind of performance for which one patiently waits through the years. 79 years later, they have returned. Tonight's program includes music performed here in the St. Francis Auditorium in the concerts from the 1930s. I selected music from those programs based largely on availability, as much of the music has not yet been located. In several cases, Carlos is singing pieces that were the only copy of the music located in the United States. And challenging to read, FYI. Also, the folk songs that were always included on the program that Delgado had gone out into communities to locate were all arranged by Anna Maude and Felipe and written out on manuscript. And at this point in time, none of those arrangements have been found. So there are certain limitations in what we were able to perform, and the Native folk songs are going to be a little short-changed, unfortunately. In addition, I must add, Anna Maude was a much better pianist than I am, so I chose the pieces that she played that I can play. And she played from memory, that won't be happening. Okay. In a typical program, Van Hoose would open the evening. She would play two solo pieces between sets while Delgado was changing his costumes, and each set would have 3 to 5 songs. So, here's my little explanation, and I'm going to hand this off so you can see the words in English. But first, I'm opening the program with the tango of Isaac Albéniz, which she played frequently, and is arguably the most well-known piece on the program. Thank you.
now welcome Carlos Archuleta, who is sharing this program with me. I found him through the help of Michael Hicks at the University of New Mexico. Absolutely thrilled that he agreed to do this. And you should explain your Las Vegas connection.
Yeah, I went to Highlands University. And I got my undergrad there, and that's where I first started really singing. So something in the water there.
That's the normal, for those of you who don't know.
Thank you.
we're drinking water, I want to say that even though they always put the next song in the Argentinian section, that it was written by an Italian opera singer for Douglas Fairbanks, who starred in the movie El Gaucho in around the mid-1920s. So it really has not all that much to do with Argentina.
And they printed it on the smallest paper known to mankind. So you might get some Spanish, you might get something a little different.
Y no te When he sang La Varsoviana and Las Golondrinas. Felipe Delgado is dead, but his beautiful voice lives on.
Thank you. Oh!